Alright, yeah.
First of all, thank you guys for coming. It's really, this is a fantastic event, and I think there's a lot to be proud of as you'll see today. So we're gonna move on fairly quickly, and I've already kind of given you the general instructions. So we're gonna kick it off here with Jennifer Hannon from Biology, who's going to work on anti-predator behaviors in the baby jungle.
Hi, everybody. As he said, my name is Jennifer Hammond, and I'm gonna be presenting the research that I and several other undergraduate students have been working on the past few semesters under the advisement of Dr. Clark. We're looking at the anti-predator behaviors in the banded gecko. Anti-predator behaviors are very common in nature. We see it in all different types of animals. A few local examples are the giant kangaroo rat that does foot drumming behaviors. We see mobbing behaviors done by birds, as well as sand kicking behaviors done by California ground squirrels. It's very costly in terms of time and energy for these animals to perform these anti-predator behaviors. So it's important that they are certain that there's a predator nearby before they perform the behavior. Therefore, they have developed keen sensory modalities that have allowed them to detect predators in their vicinity. An example of this is squamates that have enhanced chemosensory systems that allow them to see who's in their surroundings. This leads to an evolutionary arms race between predator and prey. As prey become more adept at identifying their predators, predators find new ways to hide their presence from their prey. As humans, it's most intuitive for us to understand this visually. Have you ever been to the desert? I'm sure you've seen a snake hiding in the sand like this. This is called visual crypsis. It's where the animal hides itself visually so it can best ambush their prey. This leads to an increased importance of recognizing chemicals for the prey, since it's difficult to detect them visually. As prey find ways to understand where the animal is visually, they find new ways, such as the squamates, to use their chemosensory systems to detect them. And this allows the predators to start evolving ways to hide their chemical trail. An example of chemical crypsis, a way of them hiding their scent, is the puff adder. It's a snake in Africa that has found ways to hide its scent from different mammals. This study done tested both dogs and meerkats that were successfully able to detect other snake species, but they were unsuccessfully able to detect the puff adder, suggesting it's finding ways to hide its chemical trail. We wanted to take this a step further and see if some snake species here in San Diego exhibit the same type of chemical crypsis. So we picked the sidewinder rattlesnake and the glossy snake as our two snake species. They have very similar ecology, they have very similar diets, and live in the same type of areas. However, the sidewinder rattlesnake is more of an ambushing forager, similar to the puff adder, whereas the glossy snake is an active searching forager. Therefore, we suspect the sidewinder rattlesnake to exhibit possibly more chemical crypsis, since it would be more advantageous for it to strike at its prey. We are using the banded gecko as our prey item to see if it exhibits anti-predator behaviors against these snakes differently. We picked the banded gecko for a few reasons. definitely has evolved ways to detect its predators successfully. It has an enhanced chemosensory system, as it is a spawning, I mentioned earlier, and it also exhibits very visible anti-predator behaviors that we can use to quantify in the lab. And they are a natural prey to both these snakes. So how we would go about doing this study is we would have a plastic arena and a little paper towel with a shelter on top you can see here. We had three different trials, a control trial, a glossy snake trial, and a rattlesnake trial. If it was one of the snake trials, we would put the snake confined to this space for 24 hours to allow its chemical scent to get onto that area. And then after this 24 hours, we would remove the snake and allow the gecko to respond appropriately. And we would record this and quantify its behaviors. These are some of the behaviors that we expected to see. These definitely aren't all of them, but these are some of the important behaviors that we quantified. We had several blind observers that weren't aware of the study or the trial record what they saw the gecko doing, and we took an average of those responses. As for statistics, we used a mixed model generalized linear model, and our random factor was gecko ID, since each gecko was exposed to each different trial. First, we would compare the gecko's response to control to predator, just in a general sense. And if there was a difference between the two, then we would go further and compare the two different snakes. And we use an alpha confidence level of 0.05. So for our results, we saw that the gecko was able to differentiate between predator and no predator. And we most saw this in their time spent in the shelter. And we expect this because if they don't sense a predator nearby, they're going to want to go hide in the shelter. But if they sense a predator scent, they're not going to want to go near it. So this is, you know, pretty much what we expected. You see kind of a variance in the glossy and the rattlesnake, but that thick black line is the median, and they're very similar between the two, showing that there really isn't a significant difference in response. So we wanted to see, now that we know the gecko understands when there's a predator nearby, do they respond any differently between the two predators? So the only behavior we really noticed there was a significant difference in was the amount of time they spent freezing. So this would just be when they're standing motionless for 3 seconds or more. So we noticed they have a greater freeze time for the rattlesnakes than versus the glossy snakes. And this was a very significant difference. So this shows us that they can differentiate between predators. And we suspect that they spend more time freezing for the rattlesnake, mainly because if you think about it, if you see a rattlesnake, you're going to want to freeze and assess the situation. They're an ambushing forager, so they're going to sit and wait for something to come by. They're not going to be out looking for it. So if you're a gecko and you sense a rattlesnake is nearby, you're going to just want to freeze and kind of try and tell where they are before you start, you know, running around and run right past them. However, for the glossy snake, they're an active searching forager, meaning they'll go around looking for their prey. So freezing wouldn't really be advantageous in that way, so kind of just waiting for them to come back to you. So this is why we think there is a difference between the two. So in conclusion, we determined that the gecko is able to differentiate between predator, no predator, and even between the two predators. And as I was saying, the higher freeze display could be more advantageous for the gecko in several ways. But we didn't really see any evidence of chemical crypsis like we wanted to, and this could be for several reasons. The pup outer study I was explaining before, where it did show chemical crypsis, they were testing that with mammals, as I said, meerkats and dogs. And it's possible that mammals don't have as an advanced chemosensory system as, you know, this gecko does. Since it is a squamate, it has better ability to sense the chemicals in its environment. It could also be because the meerkat and the dog were both predators of the pup outer, not a prey item. So it could be that prey have developed higher ways of sensing the predator, since it's a higher risk if they don't. So it's, you know, more important for them to stress that in their evolution. So this pretty much leaves the groundwork for further studies. We just wanted to determine if the gecko was able to differentiate the two predators, so we can go further from here. So one thing that we can go on as test is to see if the gecko has a threat differing response. We could test maybe a shovel-nosed snake, since that isn't a predator of the gecko, and see if it responds any differently. We could also see if its increased freezing leads to increased ability to escape, if it is on more alert when it is freezing, or if it's just kind of waiting it out. And we can also see if other snake species in San Diego exhibit chemical crypsis. It could be that we only tested two species, and there's lots of snake species out there. So it could, potentially, we could see this in other species. Thank you.
We have some time for questions, and throw it over to the audience and our judges.
Yes.
Do you know what chemicals you're looking for them sensing?
There's lots of different chemicals. I would imagine it's kind of like us, where we have, you know, like sweat and things that just come off of us. Mm-hmm. It's those kind of things, because like in the pup otter study, they noticed that when it was just the snake's skin, mm-hmm. the meerkats and dogs were still able to detect it. So it's not necessarily something on the outside, it's just something they're giving off, if that makes sense. Yes.
Were there any other studies you're aware of where non-threatening type species is ignored, or?
Yeah, there's lots of different studies with threat level, and we were kind of looking at that at first, but since this study was just looking at two snakes that kind of pose the same threat level, we weren't really focusing on that too much. But there's definitely lots of studies out there where species, when they see a predator that isn't necessarily going to pose as much of a threat, they use it in those behaviors. Yes?
Do you know anything from the literature on the natural history of these two species as to, does the banded gecko represent a similar proportion of their diet for both species?
Yeah, yeah, I've looked at studies when they looked at the stock contents of both the species, and these geckos were typically about 70% of both of their diets. Yes?
So when you have your chemical crypsis, it seems like there's a lot of potential pathways that you go. You're masking, so the question really is in other species where you've seen, is it a masking, is it a change in quantity,
right.
Is it a change in your profile?
Mm-hmm. So this pup otter is really one of the first species we've seen chemical crypsis without any outside influence. So other species will use chemical crypsis, but they'll kind of do things like rub mud on them, or, you know, like even ground squirrels will rub, you know, snake skin on them to hide themselves. So this is one of the first species we've seen exhibit chemical crypsis without any outside influence, and we're not really sure if it is just lessening it or not getting it out at all. We're not really sure about the scientific aspect of that part.
Any other questions for Jennifer? Thank you so much. So we're going to stay to the sort of stated schedule instead of moving ahead. Few minutes early, so we'll start at 11:15 with our next speaker.